You're late. You're still the first one here, but you're late.
I just woke up at like 7:50.
Alarm didn't go off? Or?
I fell back asleep.
Okay. Morning.
Morning.
Okay, let's see, we'll finish, I want to finish up chapter 7 today. So the plan was actually to finish this book, which is always a good goal, and we're right on target. So next week, chapters are relatively short. So next week we'll do chapter 8, which is on transformers and motors, and then the last chapter actually. So in chapter 8, we bring in time-varying fields and then continue that in chapter 9 with radio waves and radio wave propagation. But the last topics on chapter 7 are inductance, which we'll look at first. So way back, beginning of the semester, we looked at a lumped parameter model, circuit model for transmission line, consisted of two resistors, and we learned how to calculate those from the geometry in the previous chapter, based on the conductance of either the conductor or the spacer material. The conductivity of the conductors gave us the resistance in the model, and the conductivity gave us the leakage resistance, the conductivity of the spacing material or insulating material. We also looked at, back in the last chapter on electrostatics, how to calculate the capacitance of transmission lines. Again, transmission lines we've looked at are our coaxial cable and then also the microstrip. So this is the last of the four parameters, calculating the inductance of a coaxial cable. And inductance is basically the ability to store energy in a magnetic field. Okay, so we know that when we have a coil and you turn off the source, you know, the voltage source or the current source providing electrical power to the coil, current will continue to flow. Okay, and that's as the magnetic field collapses. The magnetic field is moving the current in that case. The inductance actually depends on the geometry of the conductors and on the permeability. It doesn't actually depend on the magnitude of the current. So to start, we're going to look at probably the simplest case, a single loop of current I with corresponding field B. Okay, so here's our picture. Okay, and a good question would be, well, how do you create a loop like that that has current flowing in it? This is a model for a loop in a coil. So we'll have I in this direction. And again, we will associate a contour with this surface. The rim of the surface, our direction of integration here would be, we'll take that to be in the same direction as the current. And so associated with this surface, we have a unit vector that defines the orientation of this surface. And the surface doesn't have to be a perfect circle as I've attempted to draw here, or even flat, in which case the unit vector would change direction over the surface. It would change magnitude. It always has a magnitude of one. But we know with the current flowing in the loop, it creates an H field in the interior of the loop based on the direction of the current, right-hand rule. The loop, the field, this would be H or B, would have that direction. Okay. So that single loop creates a B field. So the inductance is defined to be the flux through the surface divided by the current. Now, I'll put on here in parentheses for a minute, single linkage, and I'll explain what that means. We'll generalize to multiple loops in just a bit, where capital V here is actually the flux through the loop. Okay, so remember, B is a flux density, so we multiply in Webers per meter squared. So we don't work a lot with flux. It appears in these in Maxwell's equations in integral form. The Webers per meter squared times the area gives us the flux, and Webers is the flux through the loop. And the units of flux would be your Webers. Now with N identical loops, the total flux is N times the flux through a single loop. And P And it's, this gets a little confusing here because with multiple loops, the flux will also increase. But you just have to be careful that you don't double count a loop, I guess. We're interested in, you know, the total number of loops and the total flux intercepted by each of the loops. And then, but we'll see that the flux through a single loop is also a function of the loops, of the number of loops. So this is the inductance when you have identical linkages. I'll also point out that this is what's called self-inductance. I'm talking about, you know, what we normally think of as an inductor. So, but more specifically, it's self-inductance. You can also have two coils in the same vicinity, and if they're magnetically linked, the flux created by one actually flows through, intercepts the conductors in the other loop. You can get mutual inductance. And that's important. It has electrical applications, as certainly transformers, which, and you work with mutual inductance. I know in circuits too, there's a big section on mutual inductance. But this is just self-inductance of a single coil. So, and we're going to look at, we'll use this definition. Define the inductance of some classic configurations, you know, the straight coil that we've looked at before. And the homework I'll give you, actually, you'll calculate the inductance of the toroidal coil. So from previous lecture, we had the H field was Ni times divided by Lz. This is inside the coil. And this was equation 719 from the text. And let me try to draw the picture here. I don't like drawing these because I have to be careful about which showing which way the windings are. And just for simplicity, I'm only going to show three loops. Current flowing in that and out this way. So probably a better way to show that is with our tip and tail notation. The arrows, but the current is coming towards you from at the top of the coil and then flowing away from you at the bottom of the coil. Reversing the current direction would change that notation. Also, winding it differently would change that notation. So we have capital N turns here. Now, previously, when we talked about this coil, I used capital L for the length of the coil. But I run into a little notational problem now because I'm using capital L to represent the inductance. Okay, so, you know, if you look back at your notes, you'll find the capital L here in the denominator being used for the length of the coil, but I'm calling that LZ now. Okay, the length of the coil in the Z direction, but it's the same parameter, I'm just changing notation. And for our flux density, it's just our our magnetic field intensity H times mu. So now that this is again inside the coil. So now that we've got the flux density, the flux through a single loop is, again, the flux density here has the number of loops in it. So we've already accounted for the increase in the flux density to n loops. But the flux then is this surface integral. In this case, our coordinate system here was actually, this was the z-axis. Normally draw that up, but it's just a little easier to draw a coil on the side like that. And so the radial distance out from the z-axis is rho and cylindrical coordinates. So a loop here has dimensions not along z, but we would be integrating over rho and then also our angle phi as we go around. So our surface integral here is mu n I over L z. And then our differential surface is for a disk in the z plane is z dot, it's rho d phi d rho. And 0 to 2 pi. And then 0 to, we call that, I guess I keep going back to my figure. The other value we need is the radius of the coil, because that determines the surface area here of the loop. Well, There is no phi dependence, so I'm going to get 2 pi there. Integrating with respect to rho, I've just got a rho. So I'm going to get 1/2 rho squared. And then that's going to, since I'm multiplying by 2 pi, I'll get mu n I lz pi. And then I'll have, again, integrating rho, I'll get 1/2 rho squared, evaluate that at 0, I get 0, evaluated today, I get a squared. So I get pi a squared there for which is the area, the cross-sectional area. Or more generally, we had this result that the field was Ni over Lz, regardless of the coil shape, the core shape, whether it was a circle, an oval, a rectangle. For a straight coil, we had this result that the field was constant everywhere in the interior of the coil. So recognizing this just as the area, we can write this as Ni Lz A. And this is the flux through a single loop due to multiple coils, due to multiple loops, due to current flowing in multiple loops. But now I'm in a, where A is cross-sectional area. Oh, the coil. And so finally, the inductance is N times the flux divided by I, which is mu n squared LZ A for the inductance of a coil. So, and that gives us some hints on when we're making our own inductors. I keep meaning to grab some magnet wire here and bring some in if you haven't seen that before, but the inductance is proportional to the square of the number of turns. So as you double the number of turns, the inductance will actually go up by a factor of 4. It's also a function of the permeability of the core material. With some iron core, which may have a permeability of 100 or 200 or more, that'll increase the inductance over an air core by that 100 times or more. And then it's also inversely proportional to the length of the coil. So the greater the winding density, the more turns per length, the greater the inductance, the shorter the coil. And it's also a function of the area of the coil as well. And the other classic case that we'll look at in lecture, and I'll have you do the toroidal coil as a homework problem, very similar to this. The H field for the toroidal coil actually depended on rho. So when you, and it was a 1/rho dependence. So when you do this integral, I think you actually get a natural log that you pick up, just like we do for coax actually. So here's the picture for coax. Have an outer conductor. Which is an inner conductor. Have a current I. The inner conductor back to the outer conductor. And again, I'm going to lay this out along the z-axis. So this dimension is rho. The other things that we need here are the radius of the inner conductor. We call that A. And then the radial distance out to the outer conductor is B. So there's spacer material, dielectric material, insulating material between the two conductors. We typically ignore the radius, the radial dimension of the outer conductor because it's so thin. And then what I'm going to consider is an LZ length of this coax. So the coax is very long compared to this length that I'm considering. Based on the current direction, using the right-hand rule, our H and B field would be coming towards you. It's easier to show them my circles. So coming toward you from the top of the conductor, the inner conductor, and then flowing away from you in the outer conductor. Now, this is actually the field equation we derive for an infinite line, a single conductor. It's actually the same for a coax. You can get that from Gauss's law. And if you think about the surface here, that doesn't change as long as we're inside the outer conductor. When our surface gets large enough to include both conductors, then the net current is zero and the field outside both conductors is actually zero. But inside, it's the same as if the outer conductor weren't even there. So for rho greater than B, the field is actually zero here. So B is B directed mu I 2 pi rho. Just mu h. So what I'm going to consider here is here's my loop of length LZ. It extends from in the rho dimension a rho value of A just at the edge of my inner conductor out to a rho of B just reaching out to my outer conductor. And so I'm interested in the flux through there. Now that little rectangle contains all of the flux, at least exterior to this conductor. If you remember, we also talked about the H field inside the conductor. There is an H field there. And really, to capture all of the flux, I would have to extend my little rectangle to the center here to capture that internal flux. But the field there, it was a linear function of rho. That inductance is called the internal inductance. It's typically so small that it can be ignored in most problems. This textbook doesn't even consider it. It's usually on the order of 10 to the minus 7th henries per meter. So hang on, let's see. So you can safely ignore it as long as you're in the micro henries or above. Your self-inductances in the micro henries are above. So we've got the self-inductance, mutual inductance, and then we've got what's called the internal inductance, and we're ignoring that. So I'm just considering the field outside the wire. So the flux, E dot BS, and I'm not really capturing all of the flux in my coax, although I can modify the equation. I'm calculating the flux in an LZ length of the coax. So it is ui over 2 pi rho dotted with this differential area. I've got z and rho. So it would be d rho dz. And it's phi directed would be the normal to that little rectangle. So rho here goes from A to B, and then my length is Z, zero to LZ. If you carry out this integral, again, there's no Z dependence, so you just get an LZ term. The integrand has a one over rho, so that's gonna come back as, that's gonna integrate, become a natural log of rho. And I'll have the natural log of B then minus the natural log of A, which I can write as the natural log of B over A. So this is mu I LZ over 2 pi natural log of B over A. Okay, so this is the flux in an LZ length. So L is the flux divided by the current, or mu LZ just cancels out the current, 2 pi natural log of B over A finally, the inductance per length is, and this is what we call L prime. It's L over LZ. That's just mu 2 pi natural log of V over A. And if you go back to chapter 3, that formula was just given to you. We're told at that time, you know, 8-9 weeks later, that eventually we would derive that formula. So here it is. I know you guys have been waiting for this for most of the semester. So here it is. Today's the day. So this is the inductance per length of coaxial cable. And we actually use this to calculate the way back in chapter 3, inductance of RG59. You know, we're given the dimensions, the B and A dimensions of the conductors in RG59. For the spacer material, it has a permeability of mu zero for RG59. Okay, let's. Two other things I'm going to look at in the time remaining. The book should be relatively brief. One is calculating the magnetic energy in a field. And then the last topic in the chapter, which I want to talk about, is actually different types of magnetic material. Magnetic energy. From circuits, and I'm not going to go through the proof. You probably did this back in circuits one. You can show that the electrical energy stored in a coil from circuits principles, starting with the current and voltage, and then the current voltage relationship in an inductor, you can derive the result that the energy stored in a coil is 1/2 L times the current squared. Here again, we're dealing with constant current. But this is true even if the current is time varying. The energy can also be found from the field energy density, which is given by, this is a lowercase w, 1/2 mu h squared. If you recall, we had a similar result for the electric field. We had an electric field density. It was 1/2 times the permittivity times d squared, the magnitude of the d field. Or actually, it was the E field. The total energy in the field then is, this is an energy density in joules per meter cubed. So to get the total energy, we integrate the energy density over a volume integral. And this volume integral would be over all space, or at least over all space where the magnetic field intensity H is non-zero. So for our coax, it would be between the inner and outer conductors. So just a brief example of how to use this. And in the homework, I'll have you derive this result for the toroidal coil. But We know that H field here is Ni over Lz. This is what we started with, started the lecture with. So the energy density is 1/2 mu H squared. So H squared, again, this is just the magnitude of H. So this would be mu N squared I squared and I pick up a 2LZ squared. So just squaring N squared I squared LZ squared, pick up a mu in the numerator and a 2 in the denominator to get the energy density. So then the total energy is we integrate over the interior volume of this straight coil. So and this is just a constant, our energy density inside the straight coil. So I get just the volume times that. I'll get mu N squared I squared 2LZ squared times the coil length times the coil cross-sectional area. Okay, that would be the volume. So finally I get 1/2, I'm pulling out the 1/2 again, mu. I'm also going to pull out the I squared, N squared, A over, when did my LZs cancel? I've got LZ divided by LZ squared, and then I've got I squared here. I write it like that because if you remember at the start of the lecture, I don't think I still, yep. Still have it up here actually. The start of the lecture, we derived the inductance of a straight coil. It was mu N squared A over LZ, which is right here. That's this term in parentheses. So equivalently, I get 1/2 L I squared, which is our circuit's result. So the same result you would get from, I could have started with the inductance that we had already derived for the straight coil and used my circuit's result, or I can get it from working directly with the field. The last thing I want to talk about, get out of here a little early today, is just briefly about magnetic material. Because we've been working primarily with what we call linear magnetic material. There's a really interesting application of nonlinear magnetic material, which is normally what we think of as, you know, forming magnets, but there's three different classifications of material. There's paramagnetic. Here mu is equal to mu zero. And this material has a very weak persistent magnetization. You guys are probably familiar with actually, you know, magnetizing a screwdriver or something like that, you know, using either by rubbing it against a permanent magnet or actually using an electromagnet to magnetize metal. You may have done that in, I don't know, elementary school or in high school physics lab. But this material, doesn't hold a magnetic field, isn't easily, can't easily be magnetized. So examples of paramagnetic material are aluminum and platinum. You can magnetize aluminum and it'll hold a very weak field. Diamagnetic, and use approximately U0. This is no persistent. Magnetization. So copper won't hold a magnetic field. Now a copper alloy might, but depending on what was in the alloy, but pure copper won't hold a magnetic field. And then ferromagnetic, U is much, much greater than U0. So and we've primarily been dealing with diamagnetic material. We have free space. Ferromagnetic material has a very large U relative to U0 and a strong persistent magnetization. So iron, nickel, cobalt are all examples of ferromagnetic material. Ferromagnetic materials are nonlinear, meaning that mu is actually a function of H. So for material that can be magnetized, we can talk about the BH curve. Okay, what's the interior B field in a material as a function of, you know, you put it in an H field, you put it in an H field, you put it in a field of a permanent magnet or an electromagnet to magnetize the material. So initially, if there's no internal magnetization, as you increase the H field, the internal B field will increase as well, not in a straight line. It's not. This is part of the nonlinearity. But at a certain point, as you continue to increase the H field, the B field doesn't increase any further. The B field in the material doesn't increase any further. And that's called saturation. And actually, I'll call it positive saturation here. You know, whatever my chosen direction is here for my H field. But the B and H fields are aligned, but at some point, as you keep increasing the H field, there's no further increase in the internal B field. As you decrease the H field, what's interesting is you don't follow the same path back to zero. Actually, it does something like this. And so this point on this axis, I'll circle it, represents the point at which you've reduced the H field to zero. So there is no applied field. You still have an internal B field. You've got magnetization at this point. Okay, that's what this represents. Now, if you continue to apply the H field, at this point, it's become demagnetized. Okay, the internal B field is zero. But if you continue on with the H field in the opposite direction, then you reach saturation again, a negative saturation. And interestingly, now if you reverse the direction of the H field again and start increasing its strength in the other direction, and you don't follow this line, you actually come back like this. And some interesting points here are, again, when the H field reaches zero from negative saturation, you have a different B field than when you were coming from positive saturation. This is called a hysteresis loop. And now at this point, you would stay on this outer, in this outer loop, hysteresis. So you can keep reversing and changing the magnitude of the H field, and you would keep the B field magnitude would keep cycling in that outer loop. Okay. Now, what's interesting about this is this fact that there are these two points. You know, when you magnetize the material with an H field in one direction, remove the magnetic field, it stays magnetized with a magnetic field still pointing in that original direction. You magnetize with a field in the other direction, remove the magnetic field, and your material is magnetized with a field in the opposite direction. Again, permanently magnetized, even when you remove the H field. So the application of this throughout the computer industry is this indicates that it has memory. This magnetic material has memory. You can apply a magnetic field in one direction, remove the magnetic field, it retains that direction. And then you can sense that to say, okay, well, I've reached positive saturation at some point. If you reverse the applied magnetic field and then remove it, again, you can sense the direction of the magnetization and realize that you've been negatively magnetized. So there's two different states here, even with no applied magnetic field, you know, indicated by these two points. So this is magnetic memory. So for tape drives, hard disk drives, you know, we're kind of moving away from magnetic material because there's ultimately, you know, we're trying to get more bits per material. So we're moving toward solid state memories and solid state drives away from spinning disk and tape drives. Tape drives still have their applications for large data storage. You know, it's storing many billions of bytes, but largely becoming obsolete. But this has been used for cassette tapes, 8-track tapes, for many, as well as computer data storage for many, many years. Okay, that's it for today. We'll start chapter 8 on Monday, when we actually start looking at some time-varying fields.